yourself, sir. Sing. Can you mute all one more time?
Okay.
Yes. Kotreshi, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, well, sir, I will request you to introduce. First, I'll welcome all of them. Dear participants and our wonderful speaker for today, we would like to give a warm welcome from NNF Karnataka State Chapter on this occasion of e-Web Series Masterclass. Thank you very much for joining us and being part of this webinar academic program from NNF Karnataka. So today we've got two wonderful speakers and two senior most speakers, most respected and very famous. And many of us, many of our friends, colleagues, the amount of experience they have that actually represents our age, what we are right now. That is the amount of service what they've done. Yes, I'm going to talk about two speakers, Dr. Vijay Kulkarni sir and Dr. Daded sir. So I request my NNF State Karnataka Chapter President, Dr. Kotreshi sir, to give a brief introduction about Vijay Kulkarni sir. And then I request Kulkarni sir to start the session. After his session, will be followed by Daded sir's session. And then we will, you can post all your doubts, queries. We will take up during the discussion time after both the talks are done. So now I request our president of NNF Karnataka State Chapter, Dr. Kotreshi sir, to welcome Vijay Kulkarni sir and to initiate the start of session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. And everybody knows about Dr. Vijay Kulkarni, who is from Dharwad STM College, HOD Pediatrics, and he has done a wonderful academic work in that area, especially in North Belt. From the beginning, as a basic from Dharwad group also, with associates, he has got a wonderful background of teaching faculty also. And I nice to introduce him for this occasion. Welcome to Dr. Vijay Kulkarni, start your academic studies.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. You are hearing me?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'll start my...
Okay, you can start your...
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Put it in slide, sir.
Yes, sir.
Kotreshi, sir. Mute mark,
please. Okay, sir.
You are seeing my slides?
Yes, sir. We are seeing your slides. Sir. Can you put it in slideshow mode, sir?
Yes, sir. Now you are able to see, sir?
Yes.
My audio is correct?
Very clear, sir.
Okay. Sir, I first of all thank once again Dr. Prashant and Dr. Dinkar, sir, for giving me an opportunity. And my next speaker is a stalwart in himself. I am no stalwart compared to Dr. Daded. Anyway, the topic given to me was wonderful. It was regarding neonatal pain. And before I start my presentation, I thank my postgraduate student, Dr. Anusha, for helping me out with the slide presentations and all. We are having really a challenging time in COVID time, and still I could take out some time. My topic today is neonatal pain management. I bring you greetings from Department of Pediatrics, STM Medical College. I've been in this college from last 18 years. And since inception, I've been involved in building up my department. I had a great opportunity, and I'm thankful to the management for this occasion they have given unto me. And very interesting topic today on neonatal pain management, and really how we should proceed with it. Am I clear, Prashant?
Yes, sir. Very clear, sir. Go ahead, sir.
Okay. Basically, basic question what we come today, are the neonatal perceivable to pain? So what is pain? Are they experiencing it? And how, as a practicing pediatrician or a neonatologist, where we stand today as far as neonatal pain management is concerned? Actually, there's a big definition by International Association for the Study of Pain. It is defined as an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience. And as as soon as you enter a NICU, you see the NICU buzzing up with all buzzers, ventilator sounds, so many unpleasant things. Then we keep on talking, so many people. The atmosphere in the NICU could be a very unpleasant one for the, especially for the tiny ones. So the definition of pain definitely is an unpleasant sensory and an emotional experience which is associated with the potential tissue damage. You should never forget this important word, potential tissue damage, which can lead to a lot of organ damage as well. This itself can have the physiological capability to experience pain. The child can have the cognitive ability to report the intensity or the location of their pain. So with this understanding, just let's do a little literature search. Can neonates perceive pain? What is our understanding as a pediatrician or a treating neonatologist? What do small ones perceive pain? Yes, in Berryville in 1992, Anand demonstrated that even neonates respond to painful stimuli. They respond to in a varied pattern, in increased stress response. They can have a lot of complications. And once they land up with complications, the mortality is guaranteed. Now, we all understand, and now a lot of evidence has suggested that preterm babies can have the pain perception symptom. They can develop the pain system mechanism in when they are in utero as early as 24 weeks. So we should have this understanding that in utero also a baby can perceive pain. Okay, and we should never forget that if this pain goes unnoticed, this itself can act as a stress buster, and this can have a detrimental physiological, anatomical, and behavioral effects. Okay, there is a lot of evidence which has come off late which can tell us that if this pain, if which is left untreated, this baby itself, especially a preterm baby, can have a periventricular hemorrhage in neonatal life. And this itself can lead to a lot of sequelae in the later life. And this periventricular hemorrhage can increase a lot of chemical and hormonal release, antioxidant release. And this itself can this can cause a lot of metabolic changes in the body. And the more the preterm, the more is the immaturity of the descending inhibitory pathways. So especially whenever we are treating babies of 1 kg, 800 grams or 900 grams, we should be really, a simple example would be the closing of a door, especially the NICU door. If you don't have a stopcock mechanism or if you don't have a spring mechanism, if we suddenly bang the door, then this itself can cause a lot of stress to the baby. A sudden noise itself can cause a lot of stress to the baby. The mechanosensory receptors may overlap with the C fibers of pain, and they can itself act as a stimuli. And as you all agree with me, the premature babies have a very lower threshold for pain, and this is a well-known fact. Now, going the pain, what does this pain can have an impact on the child, on especially a neonate? They can have short-term consequences, which can be physiological and behavioral. They can have long-term consequences, like behavioral responses to pain. Yet, we all agree to that pain in neonates has been under-recognized, under-treated, and frequently not evaluated or reassessed. Actually, after the end of the presentation, I'm so convinced that I always wanted to have a neonatal scoring system of pain. Maybe I'll start working on it after this presentation. Recent studies have shown that great pain experience in the neonatal period is associated with lower motor and mental indices. So it's a well-known fact that if a child is experiencing pain, especially a neonate, and we don't notice that, definitely the outcome of this child may be less. This child may not do fairly well in the school as far as motor growth is concerned and his cognitive domain is concerned. So you may not hesitate to call it as a fifth vital sign and each one of us should be educated regarding pain identification and the management. As you all know, when a baby can experience pain, especially in an NICU setting, we do a lot of procedures. You all agree with me. One could be a baby having pain when we are doing, we are putting a lot of IV cannulas, we are drawing blood, and this itself can cause an acute procedural pain. This procedural pain might be any procedure which we are enacting on a baby, or the chronic or persistent pain, a state that persists after tissue healing, usually beyond 3 months. Now, we know that it can have an acute sequelae, it can have a chronic sequelae. Then, are there any yardsticks? How to assess pain? The baby doesn't have any language to speak. So, are there any parameters or yardstick? How do we approach a neonate as far as the pain management is concerned? What are the usual yardsticks? They would help us in assessment of the pain. One would be a physiological indicators. As you all know, any baby who is kept in the NICU, usually put them on a pulse oximeter, we put them on a multimedia monitors, we try to monitor their vitals, heart rate, saturation. So any baby who has intense pain, definitely you would see some changes in physiological indicators, especially in the vital signs. It could be change in the heart rate, it could be a saturation. Then there could be a variation in the blood pressure. This itself could be more indicative of stress. Then behavioral indicators, like an eye squeeze, a baby would be trying to squeeze its eyes, a nasolabial furrow, or it cries excessively. So a baby crying excessively, I think it is in agony. It should be a more specific cause of pain. So what are bedside indicators of what are the various parameters? We can actually categorize them into four domains. It could be a behavioral indicator, it could be a motor domain, it could be an autonomic domain, or it could be a visceral domain. Behavioral domain could be a child having lot of cry, child having grimace, child having moaning, child is agitated. And when you observe this child, the child has a limb withdrawal, child could have limb withdrawal, or it could be swiping, it could be thrashing, or a child could have tachycardia, child could have desaturation, child could have pallor, flushing. So these are some of the various indicators which we can do at the bedside, which could be an yardstick of pain. And another important thing, a child has vomiting, a child has feed intolerance. Many times we always overlook. We never take vomiting as a symptom which is because of pain. We never take feed intolerance because the child is experiencing pain. We always think that an organic cause is different. But these bedside indicators of pain, which are very, very useful and which can be taken up in our day-to-day practice in NICU. You all agree with me, there's a big list of common painful procedures what we do in our NICU. It could be as simple as an adhesive tape, what we put on a ECG lead, we could put on a child, on a preterm baby, and above that we would put on a plaster for that, or a simple suture removal, or we would catheterize a baby, we would put a nasogastric catheter for a baby. It could be a long line, it could be an ICD removal, it could be a dressing change, or it could be a simple OG tube insertion. So these are all very painful procedures. Or it could be an arterial puncture. And of late, we do an ROP screening almost every second day for any preterm baby. The lid retractor, the dilatation of eyes, the handling of the babies itself can cause a lot of trouble to the pain. And procedures like lumbar puncture, suprapubic tap, venipuncture, there's so many things which can cause a lot of acute procedural pain. So, epidemiology of procedural pain, This is a very nice article presented from 95, 97, 2003. So the incidence of procedural pain was as high as 70%, 90%. So you can just see the number of procedures being done on the NICU babies, almost 60.8 per patient. Actually, we should keep a count on the amount of procedures we do on an NICU babies. So we always take it very casually. That should not be the day. On an average, so many studies have highlighted us the importance of procedures. On an average, we have minimum of 2 to 10 procedures being done on any baby which is admitted, especially the preterm babies. We should be henceforth very careful taking the yardstick into consideration as far as pain is concerned. So today, there are many tools which are available, which are called as neonatal pain tools. But of late, in my today presentation, I'll only discuss two tools, that is PIPP score and the NPAS. PIPP is nothing but a preterm infant pain scale and the neonatal PAS scale tools. So I'll be discussing mainly premature infant pain profile, and the other one would be a neonatal infant pain scale. So these two scales I'll be talking to you. This is a very important slide where you can see a child having who is in agony, where you can see his lowered down eyeballs, then his forehead, you can see the furrow there, vertical furrows. His eyes are tightly closed, his cheeks are raised, broadened, bulging, nasolabial fold deepened, mouth open squarish. It's a very classical thing when a child is in agony. Are there any recent advances as far as the pain is concerned? They tell heart rate variability. It is the interval between the heart rates affected by the autonomic nervous system. It could be an imbalance of the sympathetic or parasympathetic balance, and it could be a power spectral density analysis. Pain reduces the heart rate variability. There is something new, especially in pain monitoring. There is something called a skin conductance algesimeter. So what is a skin conduction algesimeter? It increases with pain. What it does basically, it reflects the sympathetic nervous system influenced by changes in emotions, which releases the ACG, the acetylcholine, which in fact act on the muscarinic receptors. And what does this ACTH burst cause? It causes a burst of sweat and increased skin conductance. So this has been often done in the West. They, in the West, especially in the US, there are very good models for pain management. This algesimeter reflects changes in the norepinephrine levels and heel prick. And the biggest example of the skin conductance could be a heel prick test. This heel prick increases, but sucrose unexpectedly increases it. Another important recent advances which has come off late in the management of pain, especially in the neonate, is assessing the brain function. That's the brain hemodynamic function based on the changes in the blood hemoglobin. There's something called as near infrared spectroscopy. So the pain changes, the changes noticeable in the infrared spectroscopy. What does that suggest? It suggests a neural activity in somatosensory cortex. So again, these changes can be well recorded in a spectroscope. There are many other parameters which have come off late in the market. One could be an EEG, a specific EEG, the near infrared spectroscopy, an electromyogram, a video, an autonomic a heart rate assessment, a respiratory assessment, and an MRI, a cortical response to pain stimuli. And you can have a biochemical markers as well. You can have a salivary cortisol and a catecholamine levels. Or in recent advances, you have uric acid as well. What are the long-term impact of pain management, or what are the sequelae, the neurodevelopmental impact of neonatal pain? What has been observed? This is with evidence as far as the Bayley scales of infant development at 8 months and 18 months is concerned, a noticeable lower scores, especially on the mental developmental index in both domains, in both motor and psychomotor domain, has been noticed. And the number of days on mechanical ventilator also had an impact. Greater exposure to morphine was associated with worse motor 18 months. The many changes, especially which can be attributed to the just sidelining pain, could be an impairments of growth if large numbers of painful procedures were required before 32 weeks. This again had an impact on the early head growth. What was noticed in these babies who underwent a lot of procedures, there was a significant anatomical reduction in size of the white matter and a subcortical gray matter maturation. And there was a slower increase in fractional anisotropy of the corticospinal tract. And there were a lot of noticeable change as far as the anatomical changes of the growing brain were concerned. So now coming to the main topic per se, my topic is neonatal pain management. So how should anybody go with the pain management? So what are the general measures to reduce the pain? There is no, you all agree with me that there is a consensus that as a neonatologist or a treating pediatrician, we should not take the checklist has to be put in front of a neo warmer. How many procedures have we done? And we should count on it. We should cluster care it. We should reduce the routine tests. We should not go and every day morning we should advise one test. We should advise one test in the evening. Only we should do the test. You change lot of procedures which are really required. Otherwise, you should put a cap, we should put a board, a sticker on the neo-warmer. Don't disturb this baby unless required. Once the procedure is over, do not plan another procedure. Once you have put, you don't get an IV line or a prick at one hand, again immediately don't searching for another. Give the baby some time at least, or do a procedure at least after 2 hours of gap. Minimize the number of attempts per procedure. And pain reducing needles, use a lancet, use the smallest G needle. You can as well avoid IM injections, subcutaneous injections. Be very, very careful while suddenly removing the plasters or the adhesive tape, because especially when you have put them on the preemies, especially on the primary babies less than 1 kg, especially soak or take saline or sterile water, wet the plaster before removal. After some time, slowly remove it so that suddenly don't squeeze it out. Do not apply traction perpendicular to the skin. Now, these are some of the measures which we can always take and which are really beneficial. And are there any specific measures to reduce the pain? So again, what does evidence tell? Again, there are non-pharmacological methods and there are pharmacological methods which can really help us in achieving our goal of neonatal pain management. What are the non-pharmacological methods? These strategies involve either direct or indirect manipulation of the infant's body by a caregiver. These are time-tested methods which I need not teach anybody. A simple swaddling, a simple facilitated sucking, a simple NNS, what we usually do for a 32-33 weeker. Once we switch over from a Gavage feed to a Palada feed, once we hand over the baby for a kangaroo mother care has been found to be a great tool, especially for pain management. Rocking the baby, holding the baby, cuddling the baby, massage, touching the baby. These are really very, very safe, cost-effective methods which can reduce the pain management. And some neonatologists do prefer a sound a soothing voice in the NICU where a child can sleep. Then kangaroo mother care is a time-tested care. You can see our mother being practicing kangaroo mother care. So what does studies tell us? Lot of studies as per the Cochrane 2011, that intervention with largest mean difference for treatment with non-nutritive sucking, KMC, swaddling, felsitated tucking, all were found to be effective, really very, very effective. What are the physiological interventions for pain management? It could be a simple oral sucrose solution. It could be an expressed breast milk, or breastfeeding itself can reduce the pain of a child. And now comes to the issue of pharmacological method. Are there any drugs which are really safe? Yes, there are some drugs which are used, which we all use in the NICU. It could be an opioid, it could be a benzodiazepam, a barbiturate, paracetamol, propofol, ketamine, local anesthetic, topical anesthetic. So, what does the American Academy of Pediatrics recommend on pain management? Especially, we should avoid using sedatives without analgesics should be avoided. This is the mantra of that. Then muscle relaxation should be only given after administering an analgesic, especially when you are ventilating a baby, especially a meconium aspiration baby or a premature baby. Pre-medication for all non-emergent neonatal intubations also advises vagolytic agents be strongly considered. The best choice for an analgesic agent is fentanyl. You all agree with me. We use it in and out in our NICU. Rapid-acting muscle relaxant should be considered with succinylcholine, which is currently the best choice. Role of opioids. Yes, especially a baby has undergone a major surgery like a diaphragmatic hernia, like a TEF surgery, a tracheoesophageal fistula, or a duodenal atresia. Then opioids, some neonatologists do recommend that. Then especially during immediate post-op period, opioids are most effective when scheduled at regular intervals or continuous. What is the recent advances? Yes, remifentanil has been used, but I don't have any experience about this. Remifentanil we don't use. We equally find fentanyl as more potent drug. Morphine, yes, peak analgesia in 15 minutes. Clearance depends on the gestational age. What is the advantage? It has higher, greater sedative effect, less risk of chest wall rigidity. The only problem with morphine is it can cause significant hypotension. The most safe drug could be a fentanyl, rapid onset of action, less than 3 minutes. Less effect on GI motility, hemodynamics, and urinary retention, especially when you have put the baby on a ventilation. Opioids for intubation and mechanical ventilation. Yes, as a monotherapy, the effectiveness for opioids for intubation conditions seems to be that remifentanil is the most effective, followed by fentanyl and then morphine. My personal experience with fentanyl has been quite good. We usually recommend on a routine basis any baby who is on ventilation, especially unless he is a CNS cause of ventilation or a neurogenic ventilation. By and large, for respiratory cause, we do use a lot of fentanyl in our NICU. Decreased stress, pain, improved ventilator synchrony have been reported in response to opioid infusions in mechanically ventilated neonates. Midazolam, yes, midazolam also we have quite a bit of experience, especially for intubations and mechanical ventilations. The only problem with that is sometimes it comes in the way of neurological assessment, but by and large, when we have secured the airways and when the child is hemodynamic, I think midazolam is also a good option. But the only problem with midazolam is it causes a significant amount of hypotension. We see that we monitor the blood pressures. Role of neuromuscular blockade, yes, especially when we are having when we want to do a direct laryngoscope, when we are holding a case on with an upper GI anomaly, when a child has a cleft palate, or when we are having a tracheal web, when we are doing a direct laryngoscope, when a child has a microglossia, then we can use that. There is a role of neuromuscular blockade. Then what are the precautions when we are using drugs like succinylcholine? It can cause fetal hyperkalemia, bradycardia. We have to be very, very careful. And we should be knowing how to intubate a child. We should be knowing rapid sequence intubation. So this, everybody very well knows about this. Morphine can cause respiratory depression. Fentanyl can cause, compared to morphine, very less, but it can cause respiratory depression. It can cause hypothermia. Then ketamine is another drug. Ketamine, we don't use that much in our NICU, but we use a lot of midazolam. Again, midazolam can cause significant hypotension. It can reduce the cerebral blood flow. And propofol can cause hypotension. My experience with propofol in NICU is pretty less.
See, a doctor has left the phone and gone, so you can come
after. Are you hearing right? Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. Yeah, so we are going to unmute all. Just unmute and continue presentation, sir. So there was some disturbance. Please unmute and continue, sir. Sir, kindly unmute, sir. Vijay, sir, yes. Unmute, sir. Unmute and start.
Sorry for that. I am also.
Yes, sir. Please continue.
You are able to see now?
Yes, sir. Put it in slide mode. We are able to hear also. Continue, right. Sir.
You are seeing it, right?
Yes, sir. Continue, sir. Yes, sir. Please put it. Yes,
then,
sir. Continue, sir.
There is a role of local anesthetic. Local anesthetics are popular for alleviating pain. One of the most commonly used in mixture is a local anesthetic, which is called as Emla, which is 2.5% lidocaine and 2.5% prilocaine. Definitely, Emla cream has been used. I didn't get it. I tried for it in India. We are not getting it, but especially in the West, it has been quite popular, and which has been quite safe for heel lancing in preterm babies. And in comparison to placebo, definitely Embla significantly reduces the pain caused by venipuncture on the dorsum of the hand. So my last slide, my take-home messages: we should be really very, very careful and very, very judicious as far as pain management in a neonate is concerned, because it can have long-term lot of physiological and anatomical sequelae. Every NICU, we should have devise a program to reduce the pain for a neonatal patient. And this program should include a comprehensive stepwise approach. We should have a checklist of painful procedures. We should avoid as much as possible in that day. We should have a checklist, how many IV cannulas have been put for each baby and how much gap we have given between each procedure. How was the baby doing before the procedure, after the procedure? I think a lot of these things, there is scope of so much of studies. We can devise our own mechanisms. And you all agree with me, there is a lot of non-pharmacological and pharmacological methods for pain relief. Each NICU should choose a limited number of tools for pain assessment. Nurses should be well trained in use of selected neonatal pain assessment. They should be constantly educated, they should be implemented, and they can be valuable participants in the evaluation of their infant's pain, but they need reinforcement and education. So in the future, brain-oriented technologies may become available to help objectively neonatal pain, assess the neonatal pain. This is where the NICU I work. We have a 50-bedded NICU. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity. I apologize for the audio and anything is there. I thank once again Prashant, Dinkar sir, Kottare sir for taking me as one of the speaker for their series. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. It's indeed a pleasure to listen to you. Wonderful talk. This is something which is need of the hour. Because we have been focusing on a lot of advances in ventilation or routine management of newborn. So pain management is something which we need to focus, and there are a lot of scope to publish, to study and to do research. But see, sir, you can stop sharing the slide. So I request Dades sir to start sharing. Kotreshi sir.
Prashant.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, I request you to say a few words about the presentation and introduce Dades sir. He doesn't need any introduction. Sir is the senior most person, so I request our NNF president to speak a few words about him. So today's session will be moderated by Dr. Anita. So any questions you have, any doubts you have, they're all our teachers, great teachers, who have got passion for teaching. If you have any doubts, queries, please do put it in the chat, or you can WhatsApp me, or you can send me Facebook Messenger. Kotreshi sir, over to you, sir.
Hello, Prashant. Okay. Dear members, I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Dades, because where I studied Brigham, I very much attached to Brigham itself. And he's a good academician and national neonatology chapter, and as well as NRP trainer also. And he's presently working as a HOD pediatrics at JNMC Brigham. Very nice to see all the people and very much academic mission today, because both the HOD we have received. And I appreciate the care, commitment and involvement for academic activities like getting them. Go to Dr. Dades, please.
Kindly mute all. Kindly mute all so that a lot of disturbance we are hearing. When we mute, sir, and then start.
Hello. Go to the Dr. Dades, please.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah.
So I request all. Yeah, we have muted all. Sir, you can unmute and start the presentation, sir. Dades, sir?
Yeah.
Yes,
sir. I have unmuted.
See you. Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible, sir. And kindly mute one of the. If you're using two systems, sir, kindly mute audio of one which you are not using.
No, I am not using. I am only using one.
Oh, okay, sir. Then you can mute. Okay. Over to you, sir.
So thank you, Kotreshi, sir, and I thank NNF Karnataka for having given me the opportunity to be a part of. Speaker today for this webinar. I think the work of NNF Karnataka is really laudable because they are disseminating a lot of information and knowledge to the neonatologist and the pediatrician. I think which will go in a long way to improve the care of the newborn in Karnataka and all over the India. I bring greetings from Department of Pediatrics, Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College, Belgaum, and This is the outline of my topic today, what I'm going to talk. Introduction, etiology, pathophysiology, history and physical examination, evaluation, treatment management, prognosis, and discharge. So under these headings, I will be covering the neonatal abstinence syndrome. So substance abuse, as you all agree with me, is increasing during pregnancy, and that is resulting in an epidemic of neonatal abstinence syndrome. And now onwards, throughout the presentation, I will use mnemonic, that is NAS. And this NAS is a multi-system disorder involving central nervous system, gastrointestinal tract, and autonomic nervous system. Due to chronic in utero exposure and abrupt cessation of that at the time of birth. And the diagnosis of NAS can be made based on history, clinical features, and if needed, in case based on history and the clinical features, we're not being able to make a diagnosis, then we can go in for the laboratory evaluation. And of course, to assess the severity of NAS, there are multiple tools available. And one amongst them is a Finnegan scoring system, which is commonly used for making decisions in treating and increasing or decreasing the medication that has been started. And treatment of NAS basically includes non-pharmacologic and pharmacologic treatment. In fact, very effective pharmacological treatment can, result in cure, and you need not have to use pharmacological treatment. And optimal care of these infants is still controversial, because we don't have a very good studies with a sufficient sample size and a placebo controlled trial, and also a comparative pharmacological trial. And when you are managing babies with NAS, it is always important to also consider the management of the mother, because they will also have a lot of problems, not only the newborn.
Sir, kindly unmute, sir. Kindly unmute yourself, sir. Kindly unmute, sir.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Audible, sir. Yes, sir.
So the etiology includes both illicit and licit medications of the drugs, and many of the drugs are responsible, but traditionally it is the opioid we have been number one medications causing NAS. And those includes heroin, morphine, hydrocodone, and oxycodone. In addition, there are also many synthetic opioids like methadone and buprenorphine. And also other medications like serotonin reuptake inhibitors, serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, and many of the antipsychotics. The drugs like nicotine, benzodiazepines, alcohol, and inhalants can also produce NAS. And there are certain drugs which can modify the expression of NAS, which includes gabapentins and benzodiazepines. So as I said, the incidence and prevalence of NAS mainly depends on maternal substance use during pregnancy, which is definitely increasing. But unfortunately, we don't have any data for India. I searched a lot, both NNF as well as IAP websites. So we could not get any data about use of substance abuse during pregnancy in India. And in US, the incidence of NAS has increased fivefold over the decade of 2004 to 2014. and every 25 minutes one newborn is diagnosed with NAS. And there is a more recent data from 24 tertiary care centers which reports the NAS incidence as 23 per 1000 births. So this was published in the hospital pediatrics. Coming to the pathophysiology. So pathophysiology of NAS is a very variable manifestations which is dependent on maternal, fetal and placental pharmacokinetics, neuromotor dysregulation and many other genetic and epigenetic factors. There are several mechanisms that are proposed as a pathway for manifestation of neonatal abstinence syndrome, which includes the complex interaction between neurotransmitters like dopamine, serotonin and glutamate. And also there is a lack of adequate expression of opioid receptors, kappa and delta. And of course, differential maturation of many of the neuronal circuits in the babies. And the several neurotransmitters which plays a role in NAS includes the most of the manifestation that we see in abstinence syndrome is because of the increased levels of noradrenaline that is released from locus ceruleus, a center that is there in the brainstem. And that is the center which is the major source of noradrenaline in the brain. And in case of NAS post-birth, there is increase in norepinephrine levels through its upregulation, that is increased production, and also the superactivation of intracellular cyclic AMP. The other hormones do also play a role, like decreased serotonin results in sleep deprivation, decreased dopamine results in hyperirritability, and increased acetylcholine results in sneezing and diarrhea. And stress and hyperphagia are caused by increased levels of corticotropin. This is the mechanism that is through opioid. The same mechanism of signs and symptoms of withdrawal due to other drugs also similar to the opioids, like serotonin reuptake inhibitors or serotonin noradrenaline reuptake inhibitors also result in increased serotonin and noradrenaline. TCA will have increased cholinergic transmitters and benzodiazepines will have increased GABA. So similar pathways are also seen with other medications which causes NAS. So identifying NAS infant is very, very important because it is very important to start treatment as early as possible. So before taking any history, it is very important to screen a mother by using 4 P's, that is parents, partner, past and the present. In the parents, you should ask mother whether their parents had any difficulty with any of the drugs or alcohols. Similar with partner, whether mother itself had any difficulty with alcohol, any drugs in the past or in the recent present, in the last 1 or 2 months, whether she had any difficulty with any of the drugs. So having these history will definitely be useful in identifying a mother with drug addiction or use of substances. And in case if you don't have accurate information, then we can fall back on non-specific maternal infant association with illicit use of medications. And these maternal associations include poor or no prenatal care, preterm labor, placental abruption and precipitous delivery. And the infant association includes presence of SGA, IUGA, microcephaly and stroke. So in absence of clear-cut history, I think you can use these non-specific associations. As I said, NAS is a constellation of variable signs and symptoms. Usually it develops in about a big range, that is 55 to 94% of the infants who are exposed to opioids. The most specific presentation includes a triad of hypertonia, tremors, and exaggerated Morrow's reflex. And the other presentations include high-pitched cry, irritability, sneezing, and diarrhea. These are all because of the abnormal hormone levels. And CNS symptoms are usually commonly seen with methadone withdrawal, hypertonia, hyperactive Morrow's, tremors, skin excoriations are common physical findings that we see in newborns. They can also have a seizure, but the occurrence of seizure as a part of NAS is debatable, and it was thought to be a myoclonic jerk. The autonomic and respiratory symptoms includes change in respiratory rate, change in heart rate, hyper or hypothermia, and other autonomic symptoms includes mottling of the skin, sweating, yawning, sneezing, nasal stuffiness. And these symptoms may persist for months, especially if the withdrawal is due to buprenorphine. GI symptoms are known to be associated with use of heroin, includes poor feeding, regurgitation, vomiting, diarrhea. As a result of these infants land up with dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. Due to this feeding problem and dehydration and electrolyte disturbance, they also end up having weight loss and failure to thrive. And this is mainly because of hypercatabolic state that we see, that is increased calorie demand, GI losses, and autonomic stimulation. So NAS clinical features are also believed to be due to a neurobehavioral imbalance. It is not only a result of hormones, but it is also because of the imbalance in the neurobehavior. And each infant has specific neurobehavioral competencies. And basically, there has to be a balance between these neurobehavioral competencies. Basically, there are four neurobehavioral competencies, which includes state and attention, autonomic control, sensory processing, motor and tone control. So usually a normal healthy baby should have a balance between these four states. And only if they have a balance between these four states, then they have a normal development. That means they have a normal self-regulation. In cases of NAS, this self-regulation is lost. And a result of loss of self-regulation, these babies spend unduly more time in some of the subsystems. For example, a baby may spend more time with the hypertonia, that means tone abnormalities, and it will have a very little energy to spend with, say, like attention or a state. So as a result of these imbalance, the clinical features appear. And as I said, this when a self-regulatory capacity is lost, it results in hyper-irritability, which affects developmental trajectories. So this is the, suppose if there is an exposure to prenatal drugs or other risk factors, there is an imbalance between those four behavioral competencies, that is state control or attention, motor or tone control, sensory processing, and autonomy. And imbalance in one system can also affect the other system, as shown in the figure. So if, say, for example, if there is a problem with state control or attention, it can also have a problem with not only with the central nervous system, can also have an impact on the GI system because they have a feeding problems. If the baby is irritable, if it is not taking feed, so obviously they will have a GI symptom. So therefore, this neurobehavioral dysregulation is also one of the important, you know, the pathway for manifestation of NAS. So NAS babies do present with symptoms, but it is variable. It is variable because there are multiple factors which plays a role, which includes like type of drug, type of opioid, timing of the last dose, and the cumulative dose that the baby has received or the mother has received, sorry. And sometimes onset can also delay up to 4 weeks. So these are some of the examples depending on what type of medication or the drug the baby is exposed. They can have a different durations of onset of symptoms, and also the symptoms may last for a variation of duration, which may includes like as low as 3 hours, like in alcohol, to as high as 72 hours in methadone and opioid onset. I'm talking duration also may vary from days, sometimes weeks or months. So there are a lot of variation in onset. Usually majority of them have onset within the first 72 hours of life and may last from a week or to a month. So depending on the medications. So as I said, there are certain factors which influence expression of NAS. And those underlined one, you know, like a polysubstance exposure alters the NAS expression by increasing the severity. Similarly, benzodiazepine increases NAS expression. Gabapentin results in atypical NAS display. Cigarette smoking can increase the NAS severity. Male infants have been reported to have more severe NAS. And preterm babies have less severe expressions. And also it is important, the aggressive environment is likely to exacerbate the severity, while maternal grooming in can decrease the severity of NAS. And of course, the method of caregiving or method of handling is also important, because if it is a rough handling, insensitive handling can exacerbate the NAS expression. So these all need to be kept in mind when we assess the babies with NAS. So NAS is a clinical diagnosis based on manifestations in a setting of high index of suspicion, where you have a high index of suspect, mother has got a history of drug addiction, and identifying these infants is very important for initiating the treatment. And identifying can be done, as I said, based on verbal history and also using a screening tool from the mother, which may help to identify majority of the babies with NAS. Of course, in absence of history, you can fall back on testing the infant to diagnose. And the options for testing includes urine, meconium, cord blood and hair, and each of them having their own advantages and disadvantages. It is not only identifying, you know, the
sir, kindly unmute, sir. There are disturbance, that's why we muted all. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So it is also important that you need to evaluate the mother, because they have a high chances of having other infections like HIV, syphilis and hepatitis B. So these are the lab evaluation that can be used in case if you are not being able to have a accurate history. Maternal infant urine can be used, and you can detect exposure if the exposure has happened in the last 1 to 3 days. It may be longer for TSC and benzodiazepines. The advantages is easy to collect, inexpensive, and results will be readily available. The drawback includes is, you know, some of the time, you know, mother may abstain from using just before the delivery. So therefore, providing sometimes they provide others using. So that is the drawback of using, and of course, as I said, it only reflects recent exposure. Maternal plasma can also be used, and of course, it is relatively inexpensive, and results are readily available. Of course, it also reflects very recent exposures. We can also use a meconium for evaluation, which can identify exposure that has occurred in the second and the third trimester. And of course, collection of meconium may be difficult, and it may take up to 5 days for the results to be available.
Somebody is using the Bluetooth device, I think. Bluetooth, somebody is using Bluetooth, please scan me.
So we can use also the umbilical card, and which can again detect exposure that
unmute, sir, we have muted all. Kindly unmute.
Yeah. And easy to collect, and but of course this is expensive. So these are some of the tests which can be used in case if you don't have an accurate history to diagnose NAS. Yeah. So as usual with any of the other tests, these also can have false positive results and false negative results can occur depending on the situation. For example, you can have a false positive results in case if there is use of maternal analgesics or contamination of the meconium with urine. Or false negative results can occur in case if there is an improper storage of meconium, because the test that we do on it is a light sensitive. So if the meconium that is stored is exposed to light, then we may have a false negative result. But the best yield for confirmation comes from combination of maternal urine and the infant meconium. So if you want to have a best yield, we should always test maternal urine and the infant meconium. So once we have a baby with NAS, periodic evaluation to assess the severity, need to start, adjust, and wean the intervention is very essential. And these assessment of severity of NAS can be done by using a variety of scoring systems. And one among them is, as I already mentioned in the previous slides, is a Finnegan Neonatal Abstinence Scoring System, the FNAS, which is considered as a gold standard. The modified FNAS includes 21 clinical parameters, which need to be scored every fourth hourly during the hospital stay. And if the cumulative score is 8 or more on 3 consecutive occasions or more than 12 twice, suggest that there is a need for initiation of treatment. Score for 4 days if the baby does not need the pharmacological therapy and then stop it. But of course, we need to continue scoring for 48 to 72 hours after stopping pharmacologic therapy. So this is how the scoring need to be used when we are managing babies with NAS. So of course, FNAS has got limitations. It has got very high inter-rater variability. So to avoid that, we need a repeated training of raters. Whoever is using the scale need to be trained repeatedly. And it also includes some of the less significant items like sneezing and yawning. And it also needs the baby to be disturbed because you will be scoring every fourth hourly. And there is also lack of generalizability in this scoring to a preterm infant. And of course, if you use this system, usually the hospital stay duration as well as the pharmacological therapy will be for a longer time. And if you are using this scoring system in a older infants, you need to account for the developmental progress. For example, sleep. Because one of the parameters which is scored is also sleep. How many times the baby sleeps in between the feeding? So as the baby progresses or develops, so obviously the duration of sleep will also be coming down. So therefore, that has to be kept in mind when you are using FNAS in a older infants or a mature infants. Of course, in addition to that, we have multiple tools to overcome the FNAS limitations. Another one called as Mother's NAS tool, which deleted overlapping items that were seen with the FNAS. And of course, it added irritability and failure to thrive. The items that are there in that is 19. And of course, this has not been validated well. The other tools that are available for assessing includes neonatal drug withdrawal scoring system, which has 11 items. Any score of more than 4 indicates a significant NAS. The other two includes neonatal narcotic withdrawal, which has got 7 items. Neonatal withdrawal inventory has got 7 items. And a score of 8 includes indicates a severe or a significant NAS. And of course, these all systems have got very high inter-rater reliability and good correlation with the FNAS. But of course, the studies are needed still to validate these. So in view of difficulties in using many items scoring, there was always a search for a simple method. So there was a study, you know, using eat, sleep and console method to look at length of hospital stay and morphine use. So this is called as assessing NAS by using eat, sleep and console method. This was a novel and a new approach. The objective was here, you know, this was published in Hospital Pediatrics in 2019. The objective was to reduce average length of stay and morphine use, because using the other methods, the hospital stay was longer and use of morphine was also higher. And methods used was, you know, transition from using the FNAS to ECS method to assess the NAS. And also other intervention includes education of raters in non-pharmacological therapy. And of course, morphine was added as needed. The infants included more than or equal to 35 weeks with worsening abstinence syndrome. The parameters that are looked at is length of hospital stay, number of morphine doses, and the total morphine dose the baby received. The result showed a very encouraging about the new method, that there was a decrease in average length of hospital stay from 10.5 days to 4.9 days. Morphine administration decreased significantly from 38 doses to 0.3 doses per infant. And in addition to that, there were no adverse events and no readmission related to the abstinence syndrome. So this system has been, whatever the method has been, very useful to reduce hospital stay as well as reduce the use of morphine. ECS benefits, as I said, it utilizes the functioning of the infant, that is capability to sleep, capability to feed, and its capability to be consoled And of course, because these are all simple intervention to score, you can use family members in caring for these babies. And as a result of using this ESC method, we can maximize a non-pharmacologic treatment, reduction in hospital stay, and of course, decrease in pharmacological treatment. Only 12% of the babies received morphine using the eat, sleep, and console approach. There are of course other tools available with objective parameters, but application of these is limited because of the practical difficulties and limited validated data, which uses skin coriation, excoriation, muscle tone, tremor, salivary cortisol, pupillary size. These are a little difficult to apply in a clinical practice, and of course they have not been validated. So it is also important when you are dealing with an infant with suspected NAS, you should always make an effort to rule out other causes, because common problem that we see in newborn period can also mimic signs and symptoms of NAS. For example, you can see irritability in various conditions like GE reflux, pain abdomen, brain injuries and sepsis. Fever you can see with sepsis and hyperthyroidism. Feeding problems you can have with polycythemia, immaturity, brain injuries. Jitteriness you can have in many of the metabolic causes. And also you can have seizures with again metabolic. So all these irritability, fever, feeding problems, jitteriness, myoclonic jerks are all seen with NAS. And very true that these also can be seen with other conditions. So therefore, whenever you are evaluating a baby with NAS, we should always make sure that we rule out other causes, then make the diagnosis. So it's basically a diagnosis of exclusion if you have all these. Coming to the treatment or management, as I said, the NAS treatment is broadly divided into non-pharmacological and pharmacological. There are also many other alternative therapies, but basically it is two categories, that is non-pharmacological and pharmacological. Always the therapy in babies with NAS should start with non-pharmacological therapy, and it should continue even if you initiate pharmacologic therapy and also discharge the baby. That is very, very important. And if you effectively implement non-pharmacological therapy, in fact, sometimes you may be able to eliminate a need for medication. So very, very important to remember that non-pharmacological therapy is very, very effective and easy to, and it doesn't have any side effects. And the basic purpose is to assist in regaining the self-regulation. As I say, the basic problem with babies with NAS is loss of self-regulation. These non-pharmacological intervention helps in bringing back that self-regulation. And this non-pharmacological therapy initiated when FNAS score is less than 8. If it is more than 8 on any 3 occasions or more than 12 on any 2 occasions, you need to initiate the pharmacologic therapy. So these non-pharmacological therapy are very simple. I think many of you will be using them in routinely when caring for the newborn. These are also a part of developmentally supportive care, like darkening the room, quietening the surrounding, which basically aims at decreasing the visual and auditory stimulation. Because as I said, these babies have got a problem with sensory processing. They respond abnormally to a normal stimulus. So therefore, you always look at these stimulus that we usually give, especially the visual and auditory stimulus. And the other therapy which is given as a part of a non-pharmacological therapy is vertical rocking, side laying in C position, and handheld containment. Swaddling, swaying helps to reduce irritability and hypertonicity. And what is more important is, it is always important to observe interaction between these four developmental capabilities that I described previously. Because infant responds to the environment and handling, and observing those responses will help in guiding a non-pharmacological therapy. I'll tell you what is that. So these were the four faculties that each baby has got, but these are all imbalanced, and the problem with one will affect the other. Say for example, if a baby has got problem with sensory processing, that is hypersensitivity or hyposensitivity. If he has got a problem with the touch, so what we can do is we can reduce stimulation or touching. Or if he has got a hypersensitivity to visual or auditory stimulation, we can reduce the auditory and the visual inputs. So this is only possible when you carefully observe while caring for such babies. Or for example, if the baby has got problems with the tone, so such babies who have got a hypertonicity are helped by swaddling. Whereas the same swaddling is not going to be useful if there is an autonomic control problem. Say for example, if they have a hyperthermia, so swaddling is not going to be useful. And also it is important if the baby has got, say, like a control, state control or attention problems. And this is very, very important, because if the baby persistently stays with persistent crying, if it is not quiet and calm, which will come in the way of feeding the baby. So all measures should be taken to bring the baby back to the calm and quiet, the state, so that the feeding is not affected. So all these manipulations can be done, provided if you carefully observe their responses to the handling, to the stimulation, and their activity when you are caring, and then modify your non-pharmacologic therapy so that it will be effective. So these are the pictures. I don't think rocking, swaddling, and side laying position. So one of the other way of reducing tactile stimulation is clustering the care. So you cluster the activities at a time, say like changing the diaper, giving the feed, or giving any medications. Use them, do them at a time rather. So clustering of activity is very important, and pacifiers can be used to reduce the oral hypersensitivity, and frequent small volume on-demand feeding makes the infant more comfortable. As I said, these babies have got a high calorie requirement, so we should give adequate calories to prevent growth falter. Give both baby and the mother in the same location, because it promotes development of bonding, and also it promotes skin to skin care contact. So this is very, very important, because that will calm the baby, reduce the irritability, promotes breastfeeding, and reduces hospital stay and pharmacological treatment. And breastfeeding should be strongly encouraged, as secretion of opioids is minimal in the breast milk. Alternative treatment, I think, includes say like massage therapy, acupuncture, and studies are also evaluating aroma and music therapy. I think definitely they are going to be helpful, but we still need a lot of data to use these alternative modes of therapy for managing NAS. Pharmacological treatment is indicated in as low as 27% to as high as 91% of the infants with NAS. Goal is to improve the withdrawal signs in a short period compared to a non-pharmacological therapy. And of course, multiple studies, including the randomized controlled trials, are conducted to find the optimal medications, but we still have a problem. But however, opioids remains the mainstay for managing the NAS with no clear agreement on choice of the agent. The first line medication that are used to treat babies with NAS includes morphine, methadone, and buprenorphine. The second line medications include phenobarbital and guanidine. And the second line medication should be used only when there is no response to maximum opioid treatment. So whenever the babies are on they should be on cardiac and respiratory monitor. Okay, they should be on cardiac and respiratory monitor because these can develop cardiac and respiratory complications like apnea, bradycardia, hypotension, all those things. So therefore, respiratory and cardiac monitoring once the babies are on pharmacotherapy is very, very important. Coming to the morphine, which has been used very frequently, is a short-acting opioid, remains most commonly used and preferred medication. Frequent dosing, that is every 3 to 4 hourly, allows easy adjustment. Of course, the dose depends on severity of scoring. More severe the score or more severe the NAS, more the dose. So it varies from 0.04 to 0.2 milligram per kg per dose. And once you initiate therapy with morphine, it's also important that we should remember it needs titration. And this titration is based on FNAS score. If the score is more than or equal to 8, Determine the score and adjust, depending on the score what you have. If it is less than 8, continue the same for 24 to 48 hours and then start weaning. And go for the next higher level and the dose. So this is how we can use a scoring system to titrate the dose of morphine. And once you start morphine and if you are not able to wean after 3 weeks, consider adding phenobarbital. So use of morphine may likely to result in longer duration of hospital stay. That is one of the disadvantages of using that. The other first line medications includes methadone and buprenorphine. These are all synthetic one. Methadone has got long half-life, can be given twice daily. But the disadvantage is you have a limited ability to titrate because it has got a long half-life, unlike morphine. And a recent study using methadone has shown that there is a reduction in length of hospital stay. So buprenorphine is favored due to the short length of hospital stay. It is administered sublingually. It also decreases the duration of treatment. But one of the deterrent is that is 30% ethanol that is present in the formulation is a deterrent for its widespread use. So this is the table showing advantages and disadvantages of various medications. That is morphine, no alcohol, short half-life. Disadvantages are sedation, apnea, constipation, and frequent dosing. Methadone advantage is long half-life, longer duration of treatment, and alcohol is 8%. Phenobarbital, again, long half-life. Of course, we need to monitor the levels once you start phenobarbital. And disadvantages are possible hyperactivity, long-term neurodevelopmental problem, high treatment failure, a drug-drug interaction and sedation, which may come in the way of evaluating babies. Clonidine is a promising second-line therapy, which is, you know, doesn't have sedation, no alcohol, long half-life, and monitor the label. That is, of course, it can cause hypotension. And if you suddenly stop it, may result in rebound hypertension and heart rate. Buprenorphine advantage is sublingual administration. Deterrent is presence of 30% alcohol in those formulations. So once you start therapy, you need to also know when to start weaning, because we should always start weaning as early as possible. And this weaning should stop once the NAS signs and symptoms are well controlled based on the tool score. That is, if the score is less than 8 for at least 48 hours, you should start weaning. And the dose reduction is 10 to 20% in a daily dose. It is not every dose, it is a daily dose. But there are no consistent recommendations. People use different, methods or different doses. And discontinue the treatment if the score is less than 8 for 48 hours on 25% of the maximum dose. And if the treatment also includes clonidine, first you should wean morphine, then wean off the clonidine. That is very, very important. And as I say, there are of course different methods used by different institutions. So therefore, there is a need for standardized weaning protocol so that we have a uniform outcome, and the comparison of the data will be easy if we use a standardized weaning protocols. So this is one of the protocol published in 2014, being used in Minnesota. So you need to start therapy within 24 hours of birth, monitor score every 3 to 4 hours. If two consecutive scores are more than 12, or three consecutive scores are more than 8, then you should ask either mother on opioid. If the mother is on opioid, then you should start the morphine. So the dose again depends on the severity of NAS symptoms. And of course, if there is a need for increasing the dose, you should increase the dose either by 10% or by 0.05 milligram. And of course, you should check every 24 to 48 hours and reduce the dose if the scores are so rescue dose can be given if the dose, if the scores are more than 12. So this can be used And if the mother is not on any opioids, then you can use the phenobarbital. So those, the lower one in a purple color, will help in the weaning of the doses. That is, scores are consistently more than 12, increase the dose. If the scores are between 9 to 11, no change in the dose. And if the score is consistently less than 8, decrease the dose. And when the infant is off morphine for 2 days, with the scores consistently less than 8 for 2 days, and when the infant is cleared medically and socially, the discharge can be planned. So similarly, if we have the other categories of babies who can be managed depending on these scoring system. So like this, you have a different protocols being used by the different institutes. So therefore, there is a need for uniform standardized treatment protocol for better comparison of outcomes. These babies are likely to have a lot of complications. These are likely to be premature, low birth weight, IUGR. They can have failure to thrive because of hypermetabolic state, GI losses, feeding problem. They can have seizures. And they're also at high risk for death. Prognosis is very important. Studies have consistently shown that there is a significant difference in neurodevelopment in those who are exposed versus the counterparts. So this was published in 2019 in pediatrics. So these are definitely at risk for neurodevelopmental problems. And these are identified through 12 months through adolescence. So usually they start manifesting at 12 months of age, which includes ocular manifestations like strabismus, nystagmus, as well as visual acuity problem. They also have a cognitive deficit, poor verbal performance, impaired short-term memory, and have been found to have children with them who are exposed to opioids. And these adverse outcomes are likely to be due to regional decrease in the brain volume, and also problems with maturation of the neuronal tract and microcephaly. Opioid exposed children are also 2 times more prone to other problems like attention deficit hyperactivity disorders, conduct disorders, and adjustment disorders. And of course, they are more prone for hospital readmissions, especially in presence of maltreatment, trauma, and behavioral problems. And as I said, there is definitely an increased mortality rates among those who are exposed to opioids. There is a evidence for better maternal and neonatal outcome if treatment and support is initiated during pregnancy. So if you identify a mom who is taking any of these illicit medications, we should always initiate treatment in the pregnancy itself. And there was a randomized control trial called as MOTHER, which evaluated cognitive and physical growth in those who had prenatal exposure to buprenorphine and methadone. And they were followed up for 3 years, and they found that there is no significant difference among the opioid exposed. So we don't know why this happened, but one of the explanation could be a better health care that these mothers and babies received prior to pregnancy, and that continued afterwards. This is the problem with the studies that we have with the NATs. So they also need rehabilitation and discharge. So close follow-up with the medical provider to assess the relapse, because these babies can go in for relapse after discharge. So therefore, follow-up with medical care provider is very important. we should ensure that before we plan for discharge. Monitor weight regularly to prevent growth failure. And these babies need a follow-up with subspecialties like developmental pediatrician, psychologist, ophthalmologist, neurologist, and dietitian, because these babies have got a lot of medical and developmental problems. And there is definitely a need for early intervention, because definitely these babies are at risk for developmental disability. So therefore, in order to reduce that, early intervention is required. Child welfare services need to be engaged if there is evidence of child neglect, abuse, and harm. And it is not enough to support only the baby. Mother also need to be supported, as I said in my first slide itself, because these babies, these mothers will have a lot of problems. So they may have need a mental health clinic, substance use disorder clinic, and breastfeeding support. And these type of multi-layered care is required to maintain these vulnerable mother and infant pair. So this is another study just to highlight how difficult it is to get a good quality randomized trials with respect to neonatal abstinence syndrome. This was published in JAMA. And the basic aim was to summarize key studies looking at diagnosis and management of NAS in the last 10 years. So they searched PubMed and Web of Science. The findings included, they were able to look at 53 studies. Out of that, 9 were randomized controlled trial, 35 were cohort studies, 1 was cross-sectional, 8 were case series, which included 11,900 exposed mother and infant diets. Out of these, 13 studies evaluated, established or a novel NAS assessment methods, and none of the methods which used physiologic parameters were routinely used in clinical parameters. As I said in my previous slides, those who have got objective parameters are difficult to use because they are, you know, labor intensive, they need a lot of laboratory tests, probably like a cortisol. And most substantial number of studies pertain to a non-pharmacological therapy. Majority of them deal with non-pharmacologic therapy. And among the non-pharmacologic therapy, these are all heterogeneous. One has used swaddling, another has used something else. They have not used uniform methods. So therefore, the comparison becomes difficult. And there were only 5 randomized controlled trials with pre-specified sample tested for a different pharmacological intervention. So these were only the 5 studies which are good quality, but they were small. That is another drawback of this study. And what this evidence shows, that there is insufficient evidence to establish association between diagnostic or treatment approaches and neurodevelopmental outcome. None of the studies evaluated this aspect. They did not look at the diagnostic and treatment approaches and its impact on neurodevelopment, which is very, very important. So the conclusion is that evidence related to diagnosis and treatment of NAS are based on a small and a low quality studies. So we definitely need a good quality randomized controlled trial looking at, you know, the monitoring and evaluation and treatment and their outcome. And there is also need for trials focusing on relation between neurodevelopment and diagnostic or treatment strategy that are needed. So this is the need of the hour. So we need a good quality evidence to manage these babies with NAS so that we are sure that we are managing them properly and their outcome will be good, that they have a better neurodevelopmental outcome. So these were my references for this talk. Thank you very much for the patient hearing.
Thank you very much, sir. Wonderful presentation, sir. You are a great teacher. Every time to be a wonderful teacher, he is always a special. Thank you very much for enlightening us. I request Dr. Anita. Pranita, kindly unmute and please start the session with the red, sir. Unmute the. Yeah. Please go ahead. Start the session.
Good evening, everyone. It's a great honor and also in fact a blessing to be a moderator for two of the very senior faculty from North Karnataka. And that is, sir, being my undergraduate teacher, it's an honor to listen to you, sir. I must say that. And thank you both the speakers for a comprehensive coverage of the topics that were given to you. Both the topics being very tough, and you made it look so easy. Here are a few of the questions to Dr. Vijay Kulkarni, sir, if I may ask.
You can start with the red, sir, and then you can go with the red.
Okay, sir. Yes. So the first question to Dr. Dharit sir will be, since this neonatal abstinence syndrome overlaps with many of the common morbidities in neonatal clinical centers look for by diagnosing neonatal abstinence syndrome.
The voice is breaking. Clear. Can you repeat again?
Voice is breaking.
Anita,
sir,
voice is breaking. You're audible, but I think the network is breaking. Yeah, you're audible, but it's breaking. Voice is breaking.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can ask now.
The way she can type.
We can't hear. Dr. Anita, can you type the question?
You can type the question.
Dr. Anita, can you type the question? Your voice is breaking. Yes. Please type it. Yes, type it. Break it. Break it.
Sir,
can
I type it?
Anita, I think you have sent a question. Since NASH overlaps with other
Okay, sir. Sir, I have sent you a photograph of my question. What's that, sir?
Any clinical pointers suggest NASH, especially with limited natal history.
Sorry?
Sir, she is asking the question which has come to her. Since NAS overlaps with other community, only clinical pointers to suggest NAS specifically with limited natal history. What are the clinical features to suggest towards NAS?
That's what in absence of what is more important is history of exposure is very important, and if you don't have a history of exposure, the only way to confirm that it is NAS, you need to look at the investigations. Otherwise based on only the clinical features, it is difficult because there are many overlapping other clinical situations which can mimic NAS. So as I said, if there is a history, yes, go ahead, you are more sure that it is NAS. If there is no history of exposure in the mom, then there is no other way other than doing the lab evaluation. It's very difficult because there are similar signs and symptoms due to other diseases that we see routinely in newborn period.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question. From your vast experience, could you please share the common abstinence syndrome that you have come across?
I'm sorry, actually, I wanted to declare in the beginning itself, I have not seen a single case of abstinence. In fact, you all who are working in Bangalore and Metro should be able to see many because of the, you know, you see a variety of socioeconomic strata, which we don't see. We don't have any experience, absolutely. Sorry, I think Prashant, if we have seen, I think you should be able to share the experience.
But the neonates, it is tough, sir.
Your voice is breaking. Voice is breaking.
Next question is, breastfeeding practices in these mothers, infant. Dr. Anita?
Voice is breaking.
Voice is breaking, sir. Yeah. So we'll do one thing, sir. We'll take up a few questions. Dr. Srishailam, do you have any question?
Yeah. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Dalit sir for taking such a excellent topic, and it does not require any more references because whatever he speaks very meticulously and after a good study. And sir, I wanted to ask, suppose if the mother is taking some toddy, alcohol, and she stops before the delivery. Usually the routine practice is that again after the delivery the mother is started with the same toddy and alcohol because alcohol is excreted through mother milk.
But
so in smaller doses restarting, does it help the infant?
No. As I said in my talk, breastfeeding is not contraindicated because the amount of opioids or all these habit-forming drugs that are secreted is very, very minimal. So that is not going to affect. So therefore, you should always encourage breastfeeding unless there are other contraindications. Otherwise, there is no contraindication for breastfeeding in NAS.
Thank you. You
should in fact encourage breastfeeding.
Hey, I was asking whether restarting the alcohol or toddy in mother, will it help the infant to pacify?
No idea. No idea.
So, is there any other person who would like to ask any questions to Dalit sir? we have two questions for Sunny sir.
Can I ask one question?
If the
mother is on anti-epileptic drugs, the babies can have the features of NAS. If the mother is on anti-epileptic drugs, the babies can have features of NAS.
Yes, sir. One of the gabapentin can have evidence in the sense it can manifest with NAS. Gabapentin.
Sir, what is the usual time taken by the babies to recover in NAS?
That's what I have told you, sir. It ranges from 1 week to 3 to 4 weeks, or sometimes longer, depending on what medication it is. I had a table to show that the onset of signs and symptoms and duration, it may range from 1 week to 4 weeks or even a little more than that.
Sir, is it rational to use phenobarbital as a pain modulator, and what should be the dose? My question is, is it rational to use phenobarbital as a pain modulator, and what should be the best dose for this?
Which you have done?
Phenobarbital. Phenobarbital as a pain modulator, and what should be the dose?
No, the phenobarbital is the second line therapy for management. Definitely it can be used, but it has got a disadvantages. Only when you exhaust the first line medication like morphine, buprenorphine and methadone, in case if there is no response to that, then you can use phenobarbital, definitely.
Sir, what counseling should be done to parents and family members of the babies of NAS? What counseling should be done to the parents, family members of the babies with NAS?
I am not expert, sir. I think probably they need a psychiatric evaluation and a psychologist counseling, because that itself is a topic in itself, counseling. I don't have much experience. So they need to be referred. As I said, they need a multidisciplinary, help. Mothers.
Thank you very much, sir.
Welcome, sir.
Hello,
Prashant.
Yes, sir. Can lignocaine be used as a replacement for Emla?
I'm not hearing you, Prashant.
Sir, can lignocaine instead of Emla? If we are using it, what should be the time gap between the application and the prick?
I think lignocaine, I have personally not used it. I have not used it as a pain recipient for a neonate. I have not used it.
Okay, sir. Hello. How best can non-pharmacological and pharmacological modalities be combined for pain relief?
I think non-pharmacological evidences are far better, definitely. I think kangaroo mother care would be the best initiative, especially for weight gain. The best evidence of a baby's well-being would be the weight gain of the baby. Okay, so kangaroo mother care, then cuddling of the baby, then I think those, along with that combination, yes, opiate drops or a simple dolopal drop should help for pain relief of the baby.
Okay, sir. So there is one more question. What is the pain relief strategy for ROP screenings in your unit?
So we usually put them on paracetamol drops.
We don't use any anything like fentanyl or anything. We don't use. We usually half an hour before we use them, this pupil dilators. Then we give them paracetamol drops. Paracetamol drops. Couple of babies, I had one very bad experience of a baby having an arrest during ROP screening. So I had a very tough time salvaging that baby. So I don't know how it went into apnea and it was a preterm baby. Then we usually give simple paracetamol drops. Usually we put an IV line. We put an IV line if we are uncertain that the baby is having hemodynamic instability. We observe the baby, we shift them inside after an ROP procedure. We shift them and the best modality would be to give IV fentanyl if at all we have some issues or hemodynamic instability. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
But there's a lot of disturbance, Prashant.
Yes, sir. The background noise is there. We have muted all. Still, there are a lot of noise. You are able to hear.
Your voice is breaking.
Am I audible now, sir? Is it fine?
Yeah, now I am fine. Yeah.
Yes, sir. One more question is the quiet hours in NICU. The pain-free hours where the procedures are not being. What is your experience and how? Good it is to follow quiet hours in NICU.
No, I didn't get your question. It is breaking.
Sir, quiet hours in NICU, they are asking about the quiet hours.
Quiet hours, nothing.
Yes, sir. So, what is your experience on that? What do you like to tell the people?
Actually, seriously, Prashant, once you gave me the talk, I started seeing it in a very different perspective. I want to start that in my NICU now. I never thought pain as a major problem. I actually want to start that at least for 4 to 6 hours, quiet 3 hours. I want to start that, honestly.
Okay. Sir, Dadesh, sir, would you like to add your experience on this, sir?
Sorry, I could not hear that. It was breaking.
Quiet hours in a day in an ICU, where we collect all the procedures at one particular time, in one particular day, time of the day, we don't disturb the baby. So, what is your experience they're asking?
We don't have any protocol like that, but what we try to do is we try not to disturb them unnecessarily. We don't say quite a particular amount of hours or anything. As I said, we try to cluster them. In the night, we disturb them less. But still, you know, there will be a disturbance in the form of feeding at least. If not the other activities which you can postpone, you can adjust them. But I think definitely there will be some amount of disturbance due to feeding. And I think it will be extremely difficult, you know, not to disturb a baby, especially if the baby is on feeds. Of course, if it is on an intravenous fluid, then I think it becomes much easier to adapt this, you know, method of not disturbing for a particular number of hours.
Sir, one more question is, what are the common drugs you use in your pain reliever? Your experience in your NICU, what are the common drugs used in your NICU to relieve the pain?
We use, suppose if the baby is ventilated, we use fentanyl, constant infusion. And if the baby is not ventilated, if there is a, say like a post-operative pain, we use paracetamol 8th hourly or 6th hourly intravenous and for 3 to 4 days. Of course, we don't have a routine procedure for using simple procedures which are actually important, say like a veni puncture, like heel.
We don't
Can you mute all? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You can unmute, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Any questions?
From the audience, any of the participants would want to ask directly the speaker? Any of the participants have any questions?
Chidu, is the hospital there? Aiyah, nam Srikhan magga.
I think that's all.
Facility owned the pa.
So, anybody know? We've got that. That's all, sir. Questions. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Dadet, sir. Thank you, Kulkarni, sir. On behalf of NRNF Karnataka office and NRNF Karnataka members, participants who participated from all over India, thank you very much for the wonderful presentation. And we would like to thank all the participants. Potreshi, sir, would you like to add a few words, sir?
Yeah. Really happy today because both of my close associates, Dr. Vijay Kulkarni and Dr. Dadet, were present today. And so simple subjects have been done, wonderfully presented from both from North Karnataka. And their commitment is appreciable for this occasion today. I'm very happy that our KNF, they have been supported us very long and successful also. Very thankful for both the participants, both the speakers, wonderful presentation, sir. Nice of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you for the words.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Prashant, yes, thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes,
thank
sir.
You. Thank you. I'll leave now. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Bye.